Recording is on.
Okay, so hello everyone. I'm Federica Arrigoni from the University of Trento, and I will speak about synchronisation and cycle consistency in computer vision. This is a wide topic that is a general framework that can be applied to several problems in computer vision. In particular, among this problem, I will focus on motion segmentation and localization that constitutes, let's say, two parts of this talk. So first, I will start with an introduction to the synchronization problem, where I will briefly explain spectral methods and possible application. So this is a very simple example of synchronization, which is called the time synchronization. Let us consider a network of nodes where each node is characterized by an unknown state, and the pairs of nodes can measure the difference between their states, as shown in the left figure. The task here is to infer the unknown states from the pairwise measures, as shown in the right figure. This refers to clock or time synchronization, where each node represents a clock, and the task is to synchronize or disclocks starting from pairwise offsets. And this is the problem where the term synchronization originates. From this example, we can observe two important things. The first is that the solution is not unique. For adding a constant to all the nodes, it does not change the differences. And the second is that a solution exists if and only if the sum of pairwise differences along any cycle in this graph is a zero. So we can generalize this problem in the next slide by considering a group instead of the set of real numbers. And so we get a more general definition of synchronization. The goal of synchronization is to recover elements of a group given a certain number of their mutual differences or ratios, depending on how the operation is called. We can model this problem as a graph, as shown in the figure, where nodes correspond to the unknowns and edges correspond to the measures, where the link between measures and unknown is called the consistency constraint. In this problem, we have an ambiguity, which means that the solution is not unique, but it's defined up to a product with a fixed element of the group. And moreover, we can observe that this problem is well posed only if the underlying graph is connected. So the next slide, I will explain a possible way to solve this problem in the case where the group admits a matrix representation. In particular, in this case, the unknown elements can be recovered via spectral decomposition. In order to derive this solution, we have to collect all the measures in a block matrix Z and all the unknowns in a block matrix X, as shown in the form. And if we use this notation and we exploit the consistency constraint, then we get the box formula saying that the product of Z times X is equal to N times X, where N is the number of nodes. And this equation means that the columns of X are eigenvectors of Z with eigenvalue N. And this suggests that we can solve the synchronization problem by using a spectral decomposition. Then, in order to fix the group ambiguity, we can fix one element to the identity. And at the end, we have to project this solution onto the group, because the spectral method is an algebraic approach that does not enforce specific constraints of the group of interest. This formulation was assuming full measure, but it can be extended to the case of missing data by using some matrices associated with the graph that are the adjacent metrics. And moreover, it can also be made robust to outliers using iteratively reweighted least squares. So the spectral solution has been applied to several matrix groups in computer vision literature, as shown in this figure. And one example is shown in the next slide, which is the case of rotations, which admits a matrix representation through orthogonal matrices with unit determinant, as shown in the formula. And in this case, the final projection can be done using singular value decomposition. And an example where this solution can be applied is the structure from motion problem, where the task is to recover both the camera positions and orientations and the coordinates of the points in the scenes, starting from multiple images. And in particular, we are concerned here with the rotation component of camera motion. Another example is shown in the next slide, which is the case of rigid motions, which represent rotations followed by translations. And also in this case, the final action can be done using singular value decomposition. An example where this framework can be applied is the case of point cloud registration, where the goal is to find the transformations that bring multiple point cloud alignment, as shown in the figure. Another example is reported in the next slide, which is the case of permutation matrices, which are binary matrices such that exactly one entry in each row and column is equal to one, and all other entries are zero. And permutation matrices represent matches between objects, for instance, matches between key points is extracted in multiple images. And in this case, the projection can be cast to a linear assignment problem. Another example is the case of homographies, which can be identified with matrices with unit determinant. And this group is related to image mosaicing, which is the problem of aligning multiple images into a mosaic. And in this case, the projection is done by the division of the dit root of the determinant of the matrix. So now I will speak about another problem where this framework can be applied, that is motion segmentation. So the task of motion segmentation in general is to classify points in multiple images based on the moving object they belong to, as shown in the figure, where it is assumed that objects are moving rigidly and independently in the space. In the next slide, we can see a possible way to divide the existing methods into three categories, which reflect different levels of assumptions made on the input data. So from right to left, we have the case of trajectory clustering, where it is assumed that trajectories are available that are multi-frame correspondences. And usually it is assumed that these are noise without noise, as happens, for instance, in the popular Hopkins dataset. In the middle, we have the case of two-frame correspondences, where we have matches between pairs of images. And on the left, we have the case of unknown correspondences, where multiple key points are available, but we do not have information about the correspondences. And if we move from right to the left, the problem becomes more difficult to solve since assumptions are weaker but more realistic. We focus here on the middle problem, which is the case of two frame correspondences, which represent a good trade-off between making realistic assumptions and addressing a feasible task. And moreover, we assume that the number of motions is known. So we show that motion segmentation can be seen as a synchronization of binary matrices that are matrices filled with zeros and ones. In order to do this, we have to define two matrices that are the partial segmentation and the total segmentation, which are represented in the figure. The partial segmentation is represented in the middle part of the figure, and it is a local representation of segmentation since it says which points in two images belong to the same motion, but it does not say which motion it is. The total segmentation instead is a global representation of segmentation since it says which points in a given image belong to each motion. So the link between partial and total segmentation is reported in the next slide and is called the consistency constraint of the synchronization problem. And this formulation suggests that we can solve motion segmentation in two steps. In the first step, we solve motion segmentation independently on different pairs of images. And this produces the measures which correspond to the edges in the graph. And this can be done, for instance, by fitting multiple fundamental matrices to corresponding points. Then, in order to recover the unknown values in the nodes, we can do this by solving a synchronization problem using the spectral solution, as shown in the next slide. In order to do this, as before, we have to collect all the measures in a block matrix Z, where each block represents a two-frame segmentation computed on two different images. And we collect all the unknowns in a block matrix X, which represent the total segmentations that we want to compute. If we use this matrix notation, we can rewrite the consistency constraint in a matrix form as stated by the boxed formula. Z is equal to the product of X and X transpose, which implies that Z is low rank, where the rank is equal to the number of motions. Moreover, if we look at the matrix XI transpose XI, we can observe that this is a diagonal matrix whose size is the number of motions, where entry in position KK counts the number of points in image I that belong to motion K. And this implies that the product of X transpose and X is another diagonal matrix where entry in position KK counts the number of points over all the images that belong to motion K. So the product of Z and X is equal to a diagonal matrix times X, which means that the columns of X are eigenvectors of Z, where the eigenvalues are given in the matrix lambda. In the next slide, we can see that, moreover, if each motion contains a different number of points, then these eigenvalues are distinct, and hence the unknown total segmentation are uniquely determined from the spectral decomposition. This proposition suggests the following approach for solving motion segmentation. The first step is computing the leading eigenvectors of Z, where the number of eigenvectors is equal to the number of motions. And these eigenvectors are collected in a matrix U. Then the second step consists in projecting this matrix into a binary matrix, by looking at the maximum values over each row. And this is motivated by the idea that in the absence of noise, the entry that rails the membership to a specific motion is one, and all other entries are zero. In the next slide, I will explain that this solution can be interpreted in terms of an optimization problem. So let us consider the following cost function that counts the number of points equally labeled by the partial segmentation Zij and Xifj transpose for each image pair, which can also be rewritten in a compact matrix form. Then we consider the spectral relaxation, where the optimization variable is treated as a real matrix instead of a binary matrix, and its columns are enforced to be orthonormal, whereas the remaining constraints are not enforced. In this way, we get a real-life problem whose solution is known to be given by the leading eigenvectors of Z. And this means that the spectral solution solves a relaxed version of a suitable optimization problem. Then I will show that motion segmentation can also be solved using another approach, which is based on local solution. This method, as the one that I have just explained, is made of two steps. The first step is doing segmentation on different image pairs in isolation by fitting multiple fundamental matrices. And this constitutes the input to our method, which is reported in the left figure. Then all these partial results are combined in order to get a multi-frame segmentation, which is reported in the right figure and represents our desired output. So in order to do this, we have to observe that, as shown in the next slide, if we consider all the two-frame segmentations involving a fixed image, then they provide an estimate for the segmentation of that image. For instance, image one, as shown in the figure, is present in three different image pairs. However, although these individual segmentations are relatively good, there is a permutation ambiguity in the labeling of motions because each pair was considered independently of the others. And for instance, with reference to the figure, the star has the yellow label in one pair, whereas it has the purple label in another pair. And this problem can be solved by permutation synchronization, as I will show later in the next slide. Then, after solving this ambiguity, we have several candidate labels for each point in each image. And at this point, the most frequent label is chosen, as shown in the bottom figure. Now, I will show how we can solve the permutation ambiguity permutation synchronization. And in order to do this, we need a graph representation of the problem where each vertex corresponds to one pair of images and an edge is present between two vertices if and only if the associated pairs have one image in common. First, we compute a permutation matrix for each edge by solving a linear assignment problem. Then we compute permutations associated to all the nodes by solving a permutation synchronization problem, which can be solved using the spectral solution. And these permutations represent a possible relabeling of motions in individual pairs in order to get a consistency across all the pairs so that the same motion has the same in different pairs. And finally, we can observe that the size of permutation matrices is equal to the number of motions, which is known by assumption. So This slide reports a summary of this method, which starts from multiple two-frame segmentations, and then it combines these local results in order to get a multi-frame segmentation, where first the permutation ambiguity is solved via permutation synchronization, and then we perform robust voting in order to handle noise. We can observe that this approach is local since each image is segmented based on its neighbors only. And there are other approaches exploiting a similar idea in the case of rotations and rigid motions. Then I will show some experimental results on several datasets. First, we consider the popular Hopkins dataset, which is a dataset suitable for trajectory clustering since it provides noise-free trajectories across multiple images. The error here is the misclassification error, which is the percentage of misclassified points over the total amount of points. The results of our methods are shown in red in the right part of the table, and we can see that results are reasonably good, and moreover, the fact that our methods are not the best is expected, since we are making more difficult assumptions than the literature, since we assume pairwise matches instead of multi-view trajectories. Then we also consider a dataset in the next slide, which represents moving objects in an indoor environment, where matches between images were computed with the SIFT. The local solution is called MOD and achieves the lowest error in all the datasets, whereas the spectral solution called SYNC is better than the other competitors, but it has a few failure cases. Then in the next slide, I reported some visual results for visualization purposes, which refer to some outdoor sequences where the different colors represent the different motions. Now I will report some concluding remarks about the experiment. We showed that with reference to the initial taxonomy of the literature, if we consider the methods belonging to a specific category, then they are suboptimal when applied to the task associated to another category. And if we consider the case of two-frame correspondences, then the local solution is more accurate than the spectral solution. Now, I will show some concluding remarks about the first part of my talk. So the spectral solution has several advantages. First of all, it is very general, as it can be applied to any group admitting matrix representation, such as rotations, rigid motions, permutations, homographies, and also to sets that do not have the structure of a group, such as the case of binary matrices. Moreover, it involves a variety of applications in computer vision, including structure from motion, registration, matching, mosaicing, and motion segmentation. And finally, it entails a simple implementation made of a spectral decomposition and a final projection step. The drawback is that this is an approximate solution that does not enforce the geometric constraints, and hence its performance can be suboptimal. Moreover, we show that the local solution is more accurate than the spectral method on motion segmentation datasets, and moreover, it has a modular framework, and so it can be easily generalized to more practical scenarios, such as the case of an unknown number of motions. However, this algorithm is specific for the motion segmentation problem, so it cannot be generalized to other applications. Now I will move to the second part of my talk, which is about cycle consistency and localization. And in particular, I will start with an introduction to translation synchronization and localization problem. So the task of translation synchronization is to recover the position of some nodes in the space starting from pairwise differences, as stated by the consistency constraint. And the solution here is defined up to a global translation. In the next slide, we see that this problem can be solved by using a linear system of equations, which can also be rewritten in a compact matrix form if we collect all the unknowns in a matrix X and all the measures in a matrix Z, and we use the incidence matrix of the graph and the Kronecker product. And this equivalent formulation, which is the boxed formula, is particularly useful because it reveals that if the graph is connected, then this system is rank deficient, where this rank deficiency corresponds to the translation ambiguity. Then, translation synchronization is an example of the more general localization problem. In the next slide, you can see that there are several localization problems where, in general, the task is to compute position of some nodes given measures on the edges, where these measures can be either directions or distances or differences. In particular, we are interested here in the direction-based localization, which is also known as bearing-based localization, which is not a synchronization problem according to the definition given at the beginning of the talk, because we do not have differences on the edges, but only directions, whereas the magnitude is unknown. Then, now I will focus on this problem, which is bearing-based localization, and the related theory of parallel rigidity. In general, the task of bearing-based localization is to recover the position of nodes in this space where pairs of nodes can measure only the direction of the line joining their locations, as stated by the direction constraint. And here, the problem can be represented as a graph as before, and the solution is defined up to translation and scale. Now I will show a way to formalize bearing-based localization. In order to do this, let us consider the consistency constraint of translation synchronization, which is the first row, and let us provide this constraint in terms of directions which are known and magnitudes which are unknown, as shown in the second row. If we consider a cycle matrix of the graph and we multiply both sides by the Kronecker product between the cycle matrix and the identity, then the left side vanishes, and hence we get the boxed formula reported in the bottom right part of the slide, saying that the Katri-Rau product between the cycle matrix C and the matrix containing all the directions U times the vector alpha with all the scales should be zero. And now I will show in the next slide the meaning of this equation. First, given a graph, we have to compute a cycle basis, which is a minimal set of cycles such that each cycle in the graph can be expressed as a combination of these simple cycles. Then, given a cycle matrix, we represent it as a cycle matrix, where each row corresponds to one cycle and each column corresponds to one edge, where positive and negative entries correspond to edges traversed in forward or backward direction. Then, if we look at the equation derived in the previous slide, we can see that this equation means that we are imposing cycle consistency, which means that the sum of differences along any cycle in a basis is zero. Now I will speak about under which conditions basis localization is well posed. First, in contrast to synchronization, we have that requiring that the underlying graph is connected is not sufficient for unique localizability, but the graph is required to be parallel rigid. Parallel rigid means that all the configurations with parallel edges differ by translation and scale, as happens in the left figure. Otherwise, the graph is called flexible, as happens, for instance, in the right figure, where we can see that there exist non-trivial configurations that keep edges parallel. Moreover, it can be shown that if we assume generic configurations of points in the space, then parallel rigidity depends only on the graph and dimension. In the next slide, we can see that node locations can be uniquely determined from pairwise directions if and only if the edge lengths can be uniquely recovered from pairwise directions. And as a consequence, we have that checking parallel rigidity is equivalent to check the rank of the Cattleya product between the cycle matrix and the matrix containing all the directions. And this result is relevant since it gives a more intuitive way to look at rigidity, since the problem is expressed in terms of cycles in the graph. For instance, as shown in the next slide, we can show that if we consider a single cycle, that it is rigid in tree space if and only if its length is 3 or 4, whereas cycles of length 5 or more are flexible. Moreover, in the next slide, we can prove that if a graph is parallel rigid, then it does not have neither articulation points nor ridges, meaning that the graph remains connected if we remove a node or an edge. And this result gives a simple way to detect non-rigid graph, as happens in the graphs reported in the figure. Then we can observe that in the next slide, if we consider the union of a rigid graph sharing at least one edge, then this is also rigid. And if we use this remark and previous results, we can characterize all the graphs in this figure in either rigid or flexible in tree space. Now I will explain how this theory can be applied to the structure from motion problem. So, in general, as stated before, the task of structure from motion is to recover both camera motion and the structure of the scenes starting from multiple images, as shown in the next slide, where it is known from multiple view geometry that we cannot compute the magnitudes of pairwise translations, but only the direction can be recovered from the essential matrices. And this means that estimating camera positions in a structure from motion system is an example of bearing-based localization in tree space. Then in the next slide, we can see that structure from motion can be represented as a viewing graph where nodes correspond to cameras and edges correspond to two geometries. If this graph is rigid, then estimating camera position is a well-posed problem. On the contrary, if this graph is flexible, then we have to extract the largest rigid component, which is the largest subgraph where the problem is well-posed. Now I will show that this theory can be applied to some popular data sets used in structure from motion. This table reports the number of nodes in each graph and the percentage of edges, which is an idea about how sparse graphs are. And moreover, I reported the result of checking parallel rigidity and the number of articulation points and bridges in each data set. And we can see here that only the graph corresponding to the Notre Dame dataset is rigid, whereas all of the others are flexible as they contain both articulation points and the bridges. Finally, in order to give a better intuition, I reported a simplified representation corresponding to two datasets, where the gray circle corresponds to the largest rigid component, and the edges outside the largest rigid component are shown in blue, and the endpoints of these edges are green if they are outside the largest rigid component, whereas they are red otherwise. So now I will give some concluding remark about the second part of this talk. So we show that synchronization and localization, embedding-based localization, are two different localization problems, which both belong to the category of localization, as shown in the next slide, where this problem requires different assumptions. Translation synchronization is well posed with a connected graph, whereas localization is well posed with a parallel graph. Moreover, I showed that bearing-based localizability can be formulated in terms of cycle consistency, which gives an intuitive way to look at rigidity, since the problem is expressed in terms of cycles in the graph. Moreover, I showed that structure from motion is an example of bearing-based localization in tree space, and most popular datasets are non-rigid. Finally, we can observe that parallel rigidity assumes a calibrated setting within structure from motion, and if the cameras are uncalibrated, we need a more general notion of solvability. So this concludes the talk, and in the next slide there is a list of relevant references, and thank you for your attention, and if you have questions, they are welcome.